come on by themselves. And I've got a set of feet. I'm not sure how important this is, but maybe it's very important. There. And in fact, I can hurry it up a bit by pressing hands over it. The list here, DSP-4 is the one. So have you ever glided a pilot?
Once.
I mean, once. You flew it?
I flew it once.
Flew it once, right. Yes. Yeah. When you reach the pedal, sir, you have to count. You have to levitate. Visuals are not behaving very nicely at the moment. Right, we are not very high, we're only 2,700, and the ground is 1,200, so we're about 1,500 feet. Yes. So we don't have a good view of the distance. There is some vertical exaggeration in the scenery, 50%. So we've never looked at our airstrip here. We have main runway 3-2 off that way and 1-4 coming back this way. And there are bitumen inserts in there and there. So that's quite a long runway, it's nearly 2 kilometres long. This one here, 2-0 from there to there, is only about 800 metres long. But the ground slopes down to the lake, to the north there. So we generally take off to the north unless we have quite a strong south wind, south or southeast wind. So that's our normal takeoff is on runway 3-2. If there is a southwester wind, which is the typical, so it comes in, oh, by the way, north is up there, right? So this is a northwesterly runway 3-2. So if we have this southwester wind, which is typical, then we generally land on 2-0. Especially for training, in that we can coast up to this starting point, turn around and take off. We don't have to push back. Naturally, on landing on 2-0, we don't need to aim right close to the downwind end of the strip. We can aim in the middle. Actually, there's a runway 2-7 in here, that's going to the west. And where that intersects is a typical aiming point for landing. It's also in the hollow, so there's no great point in trying to land on the downslope into the hollow. So then you coast, you would stop about there, except if you close the brakes, you can coast up to here. And generally we park the gliders far enough to the north so that they don't interfere with people who are trying to land on this runway here. Okay. Any questions about the layout of the airstrip? Because we have an access track around the back here, so we don't actually run cars up and down the side of the airstrip. So our other landmarks, you can see this is Lake Keepit, and the lake on the display is fairly full, very much as it is now. So it's about 15 kilometres long. As we go up, I'll point out, the lake is fed by the Namoi River, you can see it coming in here on the right, and it originates right up in the northern tablelands up here, and flows down past the town of Manila, which is at the end of this range here. That's the Baldwin Range, which has a paragliding site on it on Mount Bora there. We're going for height. Yeah, okay, we're going to have a bit. So the Namoi comes in there and it flows out the other side here and down to Gunnedah. Gunnedah is showing up as up high enough now. In fact, I'll go down a bit because we've got a cloud here. We've got the cloud at about 6,000 feet. Right. Now we're getting the airstrip on our right. So our airstrip running northwest there. This is what we call the subwall, which stops the water overflowing down to the river down here. But the dam itself, the that holds the water into the lake, is there, and the Namoi River flows off down here. And there is a village called Carroll there, and this is the Peel River coming down from Tamworth. So we've got on the right side we've got the Namoi River coming down from Manila, and on this side the Peel River coming down from Tamworth. They join downstream of the dam. Village of Carroll there. The one thing you should notice is that in all this country here, there is nothing flat. Practically nothing is ever flat, except in that area there. But then as the river goes down to Carroll, the ground becomes flat. It's very flat. It's a 50th of a degree or something like that. So all this is the Liverpool Plains in here. And that flat land would be great for landing in, except it's all full of cotton. And cotton is terrible. It's like potato rows. You can't really land on a cotton paddock. You've got to guess the way the rows run, but even then, the rows may be deep enough to catch your wingtips. And of course, the cotton field is very expensive, so the farmers don't want you to land in the market. Gunnedah in there, the river runs down. There's a little hill there at Boggabri, the next village down. All this horizon here is dark because that's the Pilliger scrub. It's a forest 50 kilometres square. Right. So between us and Gunnedah, we have these two ranges of hills. We call this one the Carroll Range. It doesn't really have a name, but Carroll is there. And this we call the Kilvin Range. The two houses at Kelvin are there. This is the Kelvin State Forest. So we call it the Kelvin Range and the Carroll Range. I'll go over there. Yeah, the visuals are not very good this morning. So You can see if we follow this down the line of hills here, Kelvin Range, Carroll Range, and then these other hills, they don't have a name, I don't think, but they run, well, south is that way, so they run off to the south-southeast. And most of that is in controlled airspace there. Get standing wave here quite a bit. It may be associated with these ranges and maybe not. You're experts on them.
Get a lot of wave in Scotland, yes.
Yes, yes. But we hill, and in the simulator, we can hill saw that range there. And geologically, if anyone knows any geology, this is very significant, this range. It is the Mukai Thrust. And there is granite on the east side here, and there is coal on the west side. So it's a very important boundary in Australia. I'll turn us around to see some more. So we're running back up the Peel River here. We're aiming virtually towards Tamworth. Tamworth is not really visible in there. It's a whitish patch in there. So that's our biggest town in the area. So the Peel River, running back up the Peel River, we get up to Tamworth. There is a village of Somerton. I'm not sure we're just there or there. It's not easily visible from here. So the control zone is centred on Tamworth, and its boundary is in here, where the river for a little while is almost parallel to the boundary. So you've got a circle of controlled airspace around through those low hills there, through here, and all the good hills down there are inside the controlled airspace. It's a sort of law of nature. This forested hill here is just 20 inches in the controlled airspace. But then further south it cuts back in there, so this area here is available to us. Of course, we can get permission to fly in the controlled airspace, but it's a field. All those hills there are about 4,000 feet high. That's the northern tablelands of New South Wales. And there's quite nice soaring in there, but of course we get fewer and fewer places to land in there. These green things are irrigation. I don't know if you've noticed, the whole world is covered with these green things.
Mm-hmm.
We're using up the groundwater at a fantastic rate. It won't last more than a century or so. Show you the traps, the worst trap for our landing. It'll be 520, it's up there, 527 knots. Quite a dramatic effect. Now, we've just come from over Lake Keepit here, and we're over the Carroll Range here. There's an airstrip there, that is the tranquil airstrip. And if we hadn't upset the owner, it would be a fantastic place to land. An excellent little airstrip. So it has nice parallel boundaries. It has a building at one end, which is the hangar. It has a windsock on it. but here, we have something that looks like an airstrip. That is not an airstrip. And if you land on that, it can be very embarrassing, which has happened. That is a grassed drainage way. All this area was very badly eroded in the 50s, and it was a demonstration area for contour banks, where they stopped the erosion by putting banks parallel to the contours on the paddocks. I'm not sure if you can see any of them down there. I think there's some there. But some parts of the fields, they don't bother with the contour banks because they know there's going to be drainage down that way. So they put out a boundary each side of it and they smooth it off so the water will run down the drainage way. And they plant it with grass, and when it rains, the grass grows. But when it rains, it erodes and gets rough. So if they're not very lucky, before they get the grass growing, they get gullies developed in the grass drainage way. So it is too rough to land on. And I'll give you the anecdote. It's about 10 years ago, maybe more now, that a visiting pilot was shown this airstrip at Tranquil by the instructor. And she insisted that this thing was what he was referring to. And he knew it was not that, but he couldn't persuade her that that was the one. So she was flying and she outlanded and she said she was on Tranquil airstrip. She wasn't, she was on there. The tug pilot came over, he had never been to Tranquil, but he knew roughly where it was. So he came over to here and she called up on the radio and said, "I'm down on your left." He said, "Oh yes, I see you." And he came down and landed on there. So they lined up the landing. It was too rough to take off. She couldn't keep control, released, and went into the fence and was jammed under the canopy. He flew back to Tamworth for fuel, and when he landed, his tail wheel was broken, so he couldn't come back. So then we knew that she was not at Tranquil, but somewhere near it, but that we didn't know where. So they went off by car in the dusk, couldn't find her. To come back in the daylight to find her. It's not a good idea to land a grass drainage.
And that's not that far from the airfield here. Keepit's not very far away from here. It's not a long way.
No, it's 14 kilometres roughly. Yeah. And by road, it's about 50 kilometres. And she was actually next to the road here, but they couldn't see her in the dark.
Literally, I've never been in a simulator before.
Oh, so, no, I thought you were flying in last week.
No, I didn't.
We will leave you then.
Yes,
right. We'll go out in the field and find our instructor or what?
Yes, you're going to
thank you.
Get yourself organized. Yes,
we'll talk later. We'll get time off later, right?
Right, yes.
Right.
So this is really just the value of what I've learned simulator.
Yeah, so never been Julia had a go at
flight. She had a go, yeah.
Right, I see. You didn't.
Yeah. I didn't know.
And you and I had a week's flying.
I've had a week's flying here.
Yeah. Yes, yes. Well, if you're, you'd like to tackle the takeoff?
Yeah, I mean.
Okay.
So yeah, give me a try, so we've got the controls.
Yeah,
we've got
turn forward is important.
Turn forward. Yes. Yeah, okay. Right. So, which one's the air brake?
That's the air brake.
That's the air brake. There's a trim in front of
it. Yes. We don't have the canopy fitted, but I've heard that it's good practice not to have your elbows out of the glider, you know. So we put them over here. Right.
Okay, give me that time.
Okay, you have control.
Okay, I have control.
Okay. stop doing it, it stops doing it.
So far, I haven't felt any of the real big thermal turbulence bumps that you get quite often.
No, we don't. It's not simulated.
Doesn't feel.
Yes, he's never tried to put it down.
Whoa! Yeah, trying to get the depth perception is quite difficult. But you need to practice that.
But what I find good about it is that even though it's not terribly realistic, do the right thing.